thank you for bearing with us through the hot environment here. That is ending our reptiles production. We are going to now introduce Bonnie Alexander again. Bonnie, of course, is a wildlife rehabilitator who specializes in the seabirds, the gulls, and everything. And this is the whole reason we are here tonight, is Miss Bonnie. I'll bring you on. When she's done speaking, please meander around as you are comfortable, but know in the back room we have all these wonderful food items, bottled water, and the donation containers to collect money for this aviary that Bonnie really needs. Thank you, Bonnie.
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you for your support and your continued interest in all our efforts. I want to thank friends at Hammonasset. I want to thank the Minocketuck Audubon Society, my personal friends and co-workers, and everybody that came out to support me. Thank you. My heart swells to bursting with gratitude. And I'm just so happy to be here and honored to have a first-year rebuild gull gnawing on my thumb.
Most lovers, Bonnie.
Yes, I do. I've never met one I didn't love. Most birds fall into one of two categories, is altricial and precocial. Gulls fall somewhere in the middle. An altricial bird is born featherless and blind with its eyes closed. Can't walk, can't swim, can't see, completely dependent on the parent birds. Precocial birds are born with a little coating of down, eyes are open, they can walk, some can swim like the waterfowl, and self-feed. They don't have to rely on their parents as much. Most gulls and shorebirds and some waterfowl fall somewhere in between altricial and precocial. This is a first-year ring-billed gull, first winter, approaching second summer plumage. And it's important to know, these are some of the smaller gulls that I take in. They're very difficult to handle, as they should be. This gull's not releasable because it's got a wing injury that froze before a good person brought it to my friends at Ansonia Nature Center. And thank you guys so much for coming out tonight. And so this is going to be our little gull ambassador. Like I said, it's a ring-billed gull. You have to sometimes determine what kind of gull or water bird you're working with to see what its dietary needs are, because these are mainly insect and mollusk eaters more than they will take fish. So you have to take that into consideration. And what you want with a bird in rehab is to make sure they have what I call psychological soundness. It's one of the criteria they must meet before they can be considered as a candidate for release. And that is... we do that by using a number of methods besides the natural food. Plenty of water for them, as they love to preen and bathe. And they are water birds, essentially. So you have to take these into consideration and make sure they have enough behaviors that are as close to natural to perform, so that psychologically they're feeling well and they can keep getting well. Because a psychologically sound bird is one bird that's one wing beat closer to release and having a second chance of being the magnificent gull or anything that they were intended to be. So I'm going to put a little more vigorous restraint on little Rainbow here for now, because she's losing her mind. And there's certain ways you can tell how old a bird is, especially a seabird like a gull, usually by the plumage or the feathers. In the winter, usually they get a wash of brown mottling or speckling. And for this particular gull, the ringbills, the mantle starts to turn gray, and they lose this mottling. And this also has to do with how many years they are. Also, eye color is another indicator of how old your bird is. This bird has black to almost brownish eyes. This is a first-year bird, like I said. Somewhere between the second and third year, the gull's eye will change color to its adult coloration, which would be yellowish-orange. And they also have very bright orange gape flanges, which haven't come yet. Also, the ring-billed gulls have a characteristic greenish-yellowish legs. But while they're this immature, they will have flesh-colored legs. So, and almost all have webbed feet. Some have a longer tail than others. And I'm probably going to have to end this shortly because... No, it's not because of my discomfort. I'm just concerned that And we are
all
as raptor people
are
afraid to go pick that bird up from her and
put it back. Well, yeah, one bird I don't do that much of. I will take in a raptor for intermediate care, say a week or so, but when it starts to get better and acting like the little dinosaur that it is, trying to kill me with its feet and playing possum, laying on its back, oh, hi. I call Christine, I call Gracie, I call all my raptor-loving friends. So, yeah, and I will take in the humble pigeon, I will take in any manner of bird, if I can help. Because the one common goal as wildlife rehabilitators that we all have, well, covering their eyes sometimes helps them to quiet, and it reduces stress for them. But shortly, if he gets any closer, my stress is going to increase. But like I said, I will take in any manner of bird. I don't care if it's a pigeon, because to me, they're just as important as a raptor, as a gull, as waterfowl, anything. I do have some waterfowl under my care presently, but they're very large. They take up a lot of space, and I just felt that bringing one here, having them running around and hissing, wing flapping, being all bossy and bickery just wouldn't be good. And you do have to take consider. They do have individual personalities, and you have to take in some birds are more retiring and shy than others. Some are more outgoing. Some are a little bit easier to handle, and some are just savage spirits. Yeah. Like any gull you will ever meet. Yeah, gull. So again, I just want to say thank you for your continued interest in me and your support for my efforts, because I don't mind being a volunteer, and I'll do anything for a bird. We always want to give them another chance being the bird they're supposed to be. So again, thank you so much, and you all are welcome to come when we get that aviary built. Yeah. Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Too, if I can, on Bonnie's behalf. As you know, they mentioned these are all volunteers, but Bonnie's aviary that she currently has is falling into somewhat of disrepair, and she really said this was something she really needed, which is why all the other volunteers, all these agencies need, these volunteers need money, but this is something that everyone really came together with, all the nonprofits, to really help her. So the ripple effects from this tonight can be much bigger than the pool that's here, right? That if you have friends that you can email, say, hey, you know what, here's a great cause. You know, it doesn't have to be just what's collected here tonight. If you move to do it, it would be a wonderful thing. And she does great work, so whatever we can all do would be super.
Thank you, Shannon, for saying that. And just so you know, there is information out in the back room where all that food is. There's a flyer with Bonnie's phone number on it, and there's also our information. We are accepting, if you were going to go home and have a check and you wanted to send it, we're accepting checks at a place called Hope, written out to Bonnie Alexander, but you can use our mailing address, which is on the business cards. So feel free to make sure you take that information before you leave.
You can also drop it off at the Nature Center.
Exactly.
And every dollar counts, and any birds that, any money that you don't donate, those birds end up right here. So we don't need to feed the vultures. Let's try and save the birds.
You are all free to fly.